We're going to look at isolation and growth of microorganisms in the laboratory, and we're going to look at it from the point of culturing and media and how we do all of this and what are the important characteristics and factors that we've got in here. When we look at this, certain definitions we have to understand. One is inoculation, which is the process of applying bacteria in or on a medium. So we take something like a culture plate that has media in it and we inoculate it. We inoculate something to grow on. So inoculation. We have incubation. It says process where, under favorable conditions, microbes are allowed to grow on a medium. When we do incubation, we have to have the proper temperature. If the temperature is not correct, it's not going to grow. So we have to look at environmental factors such as temperature. When we look at media, culturing and media, there are certain ingredients that go into it. It's like a regular diet. There has to be a carbon source. There has to be a nitrogen source. There has to be water. There may be a requirement for vitamins and minerals. And all of this has to be inside of the media itself. We also have the environmental factors, which include temperature, oxygen level, pH level, light level. A lot of times we incubate these things in the dark, but some of them may require a certain pH in order to be able to function. We look at the type of culture media we use. There is a material called agar, which we use to solidify the medium. It is basically of no nutritional value. The organisms do not produce enzymes to break it down. It can withstand high temperatures, and when we're talking about high temperatures, we're talking about temperatures up to 120 or so degrees Celsius, maybe higher. It melts, which it means it incorporates into water at boiling. So in order to get this stuff solubilized, you actually have to boil the medium. And it solidifies when it reaches a temperature that is a little bit above body temperature, which becomes very interesting because you actually have it liquid up till 40, you know, as you're lowering the temperature down to 40 degrees Celsius, which means that you can sterilize it, have it liquid, incorporate bacteria in it at about 40 degrees, pour it, and have it solidify very quickly. And it hydrolyzes below pH 2 or above pH 9, which gives it a very wide range that it can be used in. When we look at media, there are different characteristics. One type of media we have is a broth. You can see it here. It is basically a liquid material. We use it for rapid growth because it is liquid. It allows the organism to incorporate in the entire volume of it. We often use it for dilution, because we can put a little bit into it, and then we can use it to dilute it out, which we couldn't do on a solid surface. We run biochemical tests on it. This particular one is a phenol red fermentation test, and it gives us a biochemical test for the material. We can use it in culture tubes or flasks. It has to be some sort of recipient. Very rarely do we ever use it in something like a petri dish, but rather we're going to have it in a tube. We have a semi-solid medium. This is halfway between the liquid and the solid. And semi-solid medium basically allows things to move on the inside of it. It is not hard. And we often solidify it using gelatin, which is of an animal source, or agar, which comes from the algae source. We can use it in tubes or plates, because it is semi-solid. You know, we just have to be careful with it because it is kind of a semi-solidified water. And we also have solid media. You can see on the right-hand side, you've got a tube that has a slant in it. It's standing upright. It is holding its shape. It is a solid medium. We often use these in culture plates. It has agar added. Normally, it is about 2% agar. We use it for colony morphology because we can see how things grow on it and how they form. We can use it for biochemical tests. We can use it for isolation, which is one of the main uses we have. Or we could use it in tubes or plates. When we use it in tubes or plates, Normally, we have a very specific reason for it. When we look at types of media, we can talk about synthetic media. Synthetic media says it contains chemically defined ingredients added in known amounts. So if you take X amount of salt or X amount of sugar and you add to it a little bit of a chemical, you know exactly what you're putting into it. We also have what we call complex media. And complex media says it contains undefined nutrients added in known amounts. Now, what we mean by that is you take something like beef extract. There is a process by which you do beef extract. But what you get out of it is going to depend on the type of meat you use, what part of the animal you use, where the animal is grown at. So we know what's in it, but we kind of don't know what's in it. And if you look at this label here, it says pancreatic digestive casein. And casein comes out of milk, and we take a material and we digest it out of that. It says papaic digestive soybean meal. You take soybean meal, you grind it up, you add papaya enzyme to it, and you get all sorts of released material. But we kind of know what's in it, but we don't know what's in it. And then you add sodium chloride, which of course we know what's in it. So we have complex media as well. When we look at types of media, some media are selective. Selective says it allows for the growth of only one type of bacteria, and it prevents the growth of most other kinds. We have differential media. It says allows the growth of many different bacteria, but shows physical differences in colony and or media that allows them to be distinguished from each other. A differential media, if we look at this plate, we can see that the bacterium on the right-hand side caused it to turn yellow. The bacterium on the left-hand side did not. We have a difference in there. It is a visual difference. So this is a differential medium. This medium also happens to be selective because it's got material that only allows a certain type of bacteria to grow on it. So we could have both differential and selective media. When we look at growing these things, it says we're going to start out with what we call a single cell or a single colony forming unit. We are going to take that and we are going to deposit it or inoculate it onto a sterile solid medium. When we do that, the cells are going to pick up nutrients. They're going to begin to divide. And as they divide, we get exponential growth where one becomes two, two become four, four become eight, and it just keeps on going. They go together to form what we would call a colony. And a colony is nothing more than a mass of cells. We can see a colony up here. We can see this colony. You can see how they're different just by looking at them. We've got this colony here. It's still different. We've got this colony here. And each one of these are made up of probably millions of bacterial cells. So when we grow them in that manner. This kind of gives you the concept of how quickly they grow. If we look at 30 days, this says the value of a penny doubled every day for 30 days. So on day one, you got one penny. On day two, you got two. Day three, you got four. Then it goes to 8, 16, 32, 64. If you did this for 30 days, which would be 30 generations, we go from one up on the first day to down on the bottom. That would be $5,376,000, which would actually be 537 million pennies. And that's what we have with bacteria when they are allowed to grow. So you give them proper nutrients and everything, and they will grow like this, and you get this massive amount of bacteria out of it. So again, culture media, we use it for different reasons. We try and grow material on it. We try and understand about the metabolism of the bacteria and things like that.